Good morning. We welcome you to this service this morning of celebration for Frederick Taylor, and known to all of us, I would say, as Fred, maybe Pop, Dad, husband, cousin, friend, uncle. We've come to celebrate a life today who loved the Lord. And I look down here this morning, and I'm reminded that we're going to miss Fred Taylor. When we stand here on a Sunday morning or a Sunday evening, I realize over these last couple of years, we haven't been able to worship together a lot. Fred hasn't been feeling well. There was lots of physical ailments that he was battling through. But you know, today he's free from all of that. Amen. And that's the hope that we celebrate today, of knowing that Fred is free from all of that. And so we've come together to remember, we've come together to celebrate the hope that is ours in Jesus. We do not grieve as those without hope today. Our hope is in the Lord. And so I want to remind you, family, Ellie Mae in particular, and all the family today, I want you to know that we love you, that we've been supporting you, we've been praying for you, and we continue to do that in the days to come. I thank you for coming and supporting the family today, and pray that all of us together, as we share in this time of worship and celebration, that God would be of strength and comfort to each of us, and that we would sense and feel and know of his presence. Lord, we come to you this morning, and we ask that you would bless this time together, that you would present yourself around this family. And as we celebrate the glorious hope that is ours in Jesus today, and the fact that our brother Fred Taylor is in your presence, that you would present yourself around us, that we would indeed be at peace today in knowing of that reality. And so, Lord, we ask that you would be with our little gathering this morning, and that we would be mindful of your presence as we share together. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm thankful to be sharing this platform this morning with my good friends, and you all know them, Majors Lorne and Barb Pritchett. They're going to help in this service today. We're going to hear Barb at the piano, and Major Lorne will bring the word a little later, and we believe that we will be encouraged as we share together. Now, the service has been put together by the family, and we're going to sing together the first hymn that's written in your bulletin, "On a Hill Far Away." My goodness, that's the hope of the gospel. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. That's become a reality for Fred, and I pray that it would become a reality one day for each of us. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. Will you stand? And family can remain seated, or you can stand, whatever you feel to do, as we share these words together. On a hill. At this time, we're going to hear from the family as they come and share some reflections of their loved one's life, and just ask you to follow along. When one finishes, the other would come, unless you're all coming at the same time. No, all right. Bless you. Thank you, Michelle.
Good morning. Whew. For those who don't know me, I'm Fred's favorite daughter-in-law, Michelle. Actually, I'm only his only daughter-in-law. I've only had the privilege of knowing Fred for less than 9 years, but in that short period, we created a lasting bond, and I learned what a quiet, gentle, and kind man he was. He was born on July 30th, 1940, in Shea Heights to Gilbert Fowler and Lillian Taylor. He grew up with lots of siblings, and he loved them all dearly. In 1961, he met and married the love of his life, Ellie Mae, who he spent 61 years with. They had 4 children who he cherished: Rosalind, Freddie, Paul, and Elizabeth. 6 grandchildren and 3 great-grandchildren. He worked hard throughout his life as a bench carpenter to support his beautiful family. When I first met Paul's family, they weren't a hugging family at all. And anybody who knows me knows that I'm a huggable person. It didn't take long, though, when I would go into their house, that Fred would be standing there with a smile on his face, just waiting for his hug and his kiss. He adored me, and I adored him. He loved having friends drop over for a game of cards and a cup of tea. He didn't like to be beaten, and I always rubbed it in when I did. Just to get a rise out of him. One night, he got so frustrated with me because I was beating him and teasing him, he almost put me in tears. Apparently, his brother Frank used to do the same thing to him, but boy, did he feel bad after. He loved to serve the Lord and went to church regularly and loved his church family. He especially loved kettle duty at Christmas and didn't miss a year where he would sit at the kettle at the liquor store, which was his favorite spot. We will continue that tradition for him. So Christmas time, Randy, you can put me and Paul down for kettle duty at the liquor store. Fred didn't have a lot of money throughout his lifetime, and over the last number of years, he started saving his money for a vacation. He loved going for a drive around the bay. In fact, he'd like to go for a drive anywhere. His dream was to go on one more vacation before he died, and for some reason, it just didn't seem like it was going to happen. He was booked to go to Nova Scotia just before COVID hit, and his trip was canceled. Then in March of this year, he was going to go on a cruise with us, and his doctor wouldn't give him clearance to go. He would sit in his room every night and count his money and tell Ellie Mae how much he wanted to go on one more vacation. Finally, on August 1st, 2022, after getting his doctor's clearance, Ellie Mae agreed to take him on a road trip to Ontario, despite everybody telling him not to go. They got to visit their granddaughter and her family in Nova Scotia, their granddaughter and her family in Welland, and then their daughter and grandson in London, where his earthly vacation ended. He enjoyed every minute of his vacation, and his dream was fulfilled thanks to his wonderful wife, who drove all the way herself. We will miss him at Sunday dinner, his visit to our camper, on family occasions, but he will live on in our hearts forever, and we'll hold on tight to his memories until we meet again. Also, his sisters wanted to come up here today to say a few words about their incredible brother, but they didn't think they'd be able to hold it together. So on behalf of Cynthia, Ruby, Barb, Joyce, and Bob, they wanted me to pass on how much they loved him and will miss him. He was a great brother to them, and they knew he was a great husband, father, and friend. They will hold on to his memories forever. Thank you.
Kayla?
I'm Fred's granddaughter, Kayla. Before he passed away in the hospital, I was in Nova Scotia, and I had my family that was there read this letter to him, something I wrote to make sure that I got to say what I got to say to him before he passed. And I'd like to share it all with you. Poppy, thank you for all the amazing memories you gave me, from teaching me how to use a pencil, to teaching me how to ride a bike on the grass, to teaching me how to drive my first car, and most importantly, how to love my family. You and Nan are the rock to this family, the go-to, because you guys were always there to listen with open arms. I'll miss the days we were all sitting in the dining room table, eating supper and drinking tea, having Jake's dinner that you'd help make all day, playing cards with the family. I wish you could stay forever, and I hope you watch over us because we all need you. I wish we could go berry picking one last time. Just know any time I'm looking into these fields, I'm thinking of you. Every time I see a blue jay, I'll be thinking of you. I wish I was there right now so I could hold your hand and hug you. I never want to let you go. You're forever a piece of my heart that can never be replaced. And know you and Nan have had the biggest impact on my life in the best way. I'm so grateful you were my grandfather and that you got to see your great-grandchildren again. They love you, and they are praying for you as well. I love you, Poppy, with all of my heart, until we meet again.
I'm Roy Clark, brother to Alan and Fred. When Fred first came to our family to seek Alan May's hand, Dad wasn't pleased. He wanted better for his daughter. But upon reflecting and looking in the mirror, he saw himself 30 years earlier when he wanted my mother's hand. And when he saw the sparkle in Alma's eye and Fred when they met, when they were together, he knew no man should or could come between them. So Fred had to work hard to gain the confidence of our family, and he did. Dad was proud of the family that Fred and Alma brought to him. And then they had their little cottage up in Kellagrove. Dad went up and worked with them. Fred would work all day at his job in Chesterdale. Come home in the evening, have his supper, and then have to dig in and put another night's work in with Dad there at the cottage, because their family was grown, their home needed to grow too. Fred won the hearts of our family, and he deserved to be remembered. Thank you.
Hi everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Miranda. I am one of Fred and Ella May's granddaughters. On behalf of myself and the family, I would like to thank all of you for coming out to pray, remember, and celebrate the life of our grandfather. I would like to send a thank you to my mom, Christina, for coming to the hospital with us and being there for Matthew, Nanny, Rosalind, Jason, myself, until Dad, Michelle, Michael, and Courtney could come. And a very big thank you to Michelle for being the rock for all of us during these hard times and helping Nanny, Dad, Aunt Elizabeth, Uncle Fred, and Aunt Rosalind figure everything out throughout the process. I started writing what I wanted to say and share with all of you on my trip back to Newfoundland with Matthew, Courtney, Michael, and Kayla. Something about the sunshine, the blue skies, the laughs, and the tears made us all feel like Poppy was with us, finishing the last of his dream trip. Not to forget that none of us wanted to ruin Poppy's hat, so we kept it on the passenger seat headrest or in the front dash the whole trip through. And don't worry, Poppy, I noticed Michael was fixing any creases or folds on the hat to make sure it still looked fresh. I had the pleasure of spending time with Nanny and Poppy before they left to London. One thing I learned while talking to both of them was that their grandchildren and great-grandchildren were their pride and joy. They both shared many memories and stories of us growing up and stated how proud of the young men and women we have become today. One thing I noticed, and I think is something we all forget as children and grandchildren, is that we forget to share the pride in our parents and grandparents. We often hear our parents and grandparents tell us that they are proud of us for what we have accomplished, but we rarely share how proud we are of them. Poppy, I hope you know how truly proud I am to be your granddaughter. I am proud of the man you were, the life you built, the family you and Nanny raised, your big heart, and so much more. I know that you touched the lives of everyone that is here today in one way or another, and that they were and still are proud to call you their husband, dad, Poppy, brother, and friend. As I write this here today, I want to share a memory with all of you, but I find it hard to pick just one. Looking back at every memory, I noticed that every memory shared one or more special moments. With this special moment, I think many of us have giggled or laughed. We may have even gotten a little embarrassed, but it was our Poppy, and like Shrek always said, it's better out than in. For those of you who don't know what I'm referring to, let me share a story from one of my past visits to Newfoundland. I think it is safe to say that when most of us come to Newfoundland, one of our first stops is always Chess's. This one time when we drove down from Ontario, Nanny and Poppy met us at Chess's for some fish and chips. I remember Poppy sitting at the end table, Nanny and Dad next to him, and the rest of the family around the table. We're all talking away when all of a sudden, Poppy lifts his legs and lets out the loudest little fart. Me and my brothers all looked at each other, not knowing if we should be laughing or embarrassed, and to look around to see if anyone else noticed and was looking at him. Of course, there were a few, but Poppy definitely wasn't ashamed or embarrassed, but Nan was sure to say one thing we heard quite often, which was, "Now, Fred." I can stand around and tell you more memories with Poppy, and each one would have a special moment in them. Each one leaving us feeling the same, but I think that's enough for the washroom talk for now. There's a poem by Melissa Fox Austin called A Golden Heart Stop Beating that I would like to leave with all of you today. The first time I read it, I felt it describe every emotion a lot of us have felt this past week. As I read it here today, I would like all of you to close your eyes and imagine your favorite memory with Poppy. And always remember that he's always going to be with us no matter where God's plans lead. The poem goes, "A golden heart stopped beating, hard working hands at rest. It broke our hearts to see you go. God only takes the best. They say that memories are golden. Well, maybe that is true. But we never wanted memories. We only wanted you. Your life was love and labor. Your love for your family true. You did your best for all of us. We will always remember you. We sat beside your bedside. Our hearts were crushed and sore. We did our duty to the end, till we could not do no more. In tears we watched you sinking. We watched you fade away. And though our hearts stopped breaking, we knew you could not stay. Our lips cannot speak how we love you. Our hearts cannot tell us what to say. But God only knows how we miss you in our home that's lonely today."
We have quite the assurance when we know Jesus Christ and we know the hope of eternity that his children have within their hearts. And so we live and we long for the day, the glorious day it's going to be when he ushers us into his presence. The beautiful chorus that the family has included on your bulletin this morning is, "What a day that will be when my Savior I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land. You see, we're never alone, but he's always there, always there." What a day, glorious day that will be. We'll share a couple of times through, and then Claudette Hillier is going to come and share a scripture reading with us this morning.
I shall see.
scripture reading chosen for today is taken from 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 10. And it's about our heavenly dwelling. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose, and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one of us may receive what is due him for things done while in this body, whether good or bad. This is the word of the Lord.
Heaven. Perfection. No pain, no tears. We've heard it now a few times today. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are the hands that hold you now.
They were
know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now
thank you for that. And lest you think the theology was off in that, let me tell you, it wasn't. The very same body that Jesus left here with is the body he is in heaven now. The very same scars that he said to Thomas, he said, you don't think it's me? He said, shove your hand in my side. He'll carry them to heaven. And a very powerful rendition, a reminder of that today. To the family, Barb and I want to express our sympathies. We know you're celebrating today, but we also know that you're sad. And I pray that God will bless you as you come today to this service, which I know is not easy, And I also want to thank you for accommodating my schedule. And have you, the reason why you got out of bed so early this morning, everybody, and to get here was because of my schedule. I fly out to Halifax this afternoon. And thank you for making that possible. To the pilgrims and to Nikki and everybody, thank you so much. And I pray that God will bless us. People I communicate with often who ask me to be at a certain place will know that I rarely say yes unless I add a tagline. And the tagline is, I'll be there, God willing. And it's always there. It's always present. I cannot say, yes, I'll be there, unless I add that without a fit of conscience. And I've been doing it now for nearly 50 years. And the reason why is because it comes out of the book of James, who says in James 4, let me read it to you. This is the brother of Jesus, who had many surprises in his life, I would say. Look here, you who say today or tomorrow, we are going to a certain town and will stay there a year. We will do business there and make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. We know what fog is here in Newfoundland, don't we? Your life is like the morning fog. It is here a little while, then it's gone. What you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we will live and do this or that. Otherwise, you're boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. Now, interesting enough, we're bearing that truth out today here. We did not expect to be here a couple of weeks ago. We really didn't. Nobody thought we were. There were times when I thought we would be here for Fred in a funeral service over the years during the time I served here. There were days. I remember going over to Ella Mae's on a Saturday, and one Saturday afternoon, and boy, I didn't think Fred could live the night. I went home and said to Barb, I can't see Fred living through the night. And we prayed for him the next day earnestly. But he did. He surprised us. He surprised us. And not only did he live, but Fred recuperated and did a lot. And I was shocked when I heard that Ella Mae, I mean, at her age now, sorry, Ella Mae, excuse me. She'll get me. But I mean, can you imagine doing that spectacular thing? And right on, good for you. To take Fred to Ontario, to drive it herself? My goodness gracious, there are a lot of people who wouldn't have had that nerve. But that kind of courage and zip and zap has been in Ella Mae throughout her life. And she did a good thing. That was a right thing. What a gift. What a gift. But here we are. And we're here, let me tell you, we have broken hearts because it was so sudden and at a time when it was unexpected. We have broken hearts, but unswerving faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. We feel hurt, but we feel hope. We feel grief, but we also feel deep grace. We feel emotionally bruised, but not eternally betrayed. So what do I say this morning as a preacher of God's word? What do I preach? Well, some of you have heard me preach dozens of funeral sermons, so I just want you to know I'm going to say everything I said before. Not all of them. I have about 20 funeral sermons. There are only certain things a preacher should say at a funeral service. There are only certain things we need to say at a funeral service. So I have about 20 sermons, and I recycle them, and most officers do for funeral service, because it's so specific.
It's so specific. There are certain passages of Scripture we preach from at a funeral. There are certain truths that we need to convey. And while I hope my sermon makes you feel better, I do, if you really carefully listen to what the Spirit is saying this morning through me, you will feel better, but that's not my goal. My goal is to help you to feel hope, not only for Fred, but for yourself. There are things that you need to know. But if you boil down everything that I've said in all of these sermons, there are three things that I try to say in many different ways at every single funeral. And these are the three things that have helped me most in times of sorrow and sickness, times of storm and serenity, times when I've been singing, and times when I've been forced to sit in shocked, stunned silence. I've had those moments. There are three things that always helps me remember that God is always faithful and he has a plan. I'm sure of and certain now that my clear purpose this morning is to give a reason for our hope in the midst of deep sorrow. What is the Christian message? You say, what are you doing at these funerals, you know, praising the Lord and saying he's gone to a better place, and, you know, when all the evidence is that we're in trouble. Usually there's a coffin in front of you with a dead body in it, and you're saying, we're happy about where he's gone. Well, it's tough, but listen, we want you to know why we say that, and I'm going to tell you this morning. It is not going to take me long, just an hour or two. And my sermon is as simple as 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1. Number 1. And this is important, and you may not realize why it's important at a funeral, but boy, it sure is. There is one God. And everything and everyone is under his governance because of one main reason. You may think, well, I make my own decisions, Lauren. I do my own thing. I possess my own reins. I set my own schedule. I fix my own problems. You may have a long chain, but it is a chain. God owns you. He built you from the ground up. Now, I'm telling you what the Christian message is. You don't have to believe this. That's up to you. He created the world, and therefore he owns it lock, stock, and barrel. See that mercy seat there? I'm sure that wood was bought from some company who harvested in a field where God grew trees. God owned the trees. And they built this altar with hands that God made. All the resources are God's. The field that the trees came out of were God's. The men who built the altar was God. So I have to say that altar is God's. The carpet is God's. Even strange things like Major Pilgrim here. It's God's. Now, that's our philosophy. That's why we come here. There's one God, and the Bible says, and I could prove it to you in all 66 books of the Bible, but I'm not going to do that all this today. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, belongs to the Lord. Now, I know there's a lot of confusion today. I know we as Christians add to that confusion. Some say all gods are the same. Well, let me tell you how to identify our God, the God that the Christians believe in. Let me tell you some pointers about that God, lest you be confused. Our God created the entire universe, everything and everyone in it, and therefore owns it all. That's the God we believe in. 2. Our God has a son named Jesus Christ, born of a virgin named Mary, And he died for the entire world and rose again on the third day. So not all gods that people talk about have that. That's our God. Number three, our God has a Holy Spirit who lives in every believer. Yes, when I saw Fred come to the altar and confess his sins, I knew the Holy Spirit was then invading his life. You say, that's weird. We're talking about God here. We're not talking about the President of the United States or some powerful military leader. We're talking about something holy and other and distinct. We're talking about God. And he has a Holy Spirit that he puts in me. Some people say, how does he get in you? Does he go in your ear, up your nose? I can't tell you that. But I know this. He lives within me by the power of his Holy Spirit. So our God is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. One God, but three in one. I see the smoke coming out of your ears now. You're trying to process that. Good luck with it. Yes, it's confusing, but nonetheless, a very biblical sound description of our unique and totally amazing triune God, and there is only one of them. One God. Two. The Bible is very clear that there are two main parts to us, the physical part and the spiritual part. Now, we could talk about body, soul, and spirit. That would take me about 4 or 5 hours. I'll do it. If 15 people raise their hands and say, yeah, Lord, talk about that. If not, I'll just leave it at two parts of us. That which you can see and that which you can't see. That which a surgeon can remove with a knife and a hacksaw. You know, he can saw it off, cut it out, whatever. I got a very corporeal, I got a very physical part to my body that you can see. But there's parts of me you can't see. And I think the part you can't see is way more important than the parts you do see. For example, you say, you know about this because you say, oh my goodness, I have a broken heart. Well, you don't really. I mean, your heart's fine. Thump, thump, right? But that's not the heart you're talking about. You say, I feel sad. Well, let's go to a surgeon and say, what are you here for today? Well, I was feeling a little sad, and I wonder if you could remove it. No. Where's that? Where's that? I'm not going to talk about it much more, but I just tell you that there's a physical part of us and a spiritual part of us. Genesis 2:7 covers it off. It says, and the Lord God formed the man of the dust of the ground. So he pushed the dust together and formed the man and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living soul. Without that breath in him, he was not going to get up and walk around the Garden of Eden. You notice the two parts. The body without the soul is just a shuck, but the soul, with the soul, it comes to life. You see it again, you see these two parts in the powerful scene when our beloved Jesus was on the cross. And the very last thing he said was this, John 19:30. He said, it's finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now, there is some thought that in the original language, it means he dismissed his spirit, saying, you can go now. In the Amplified Version, it says this. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished, and he bowed his head and voluntarily gave up his spirit. And when the spirit left him, he was dead. His body was dead. The physical Jesus was dead. But something left his body in order for him to die. I'm going to tell you a bizarre thing. I'm going to tell you a bizarre thing. Do you know what scholars say? If you took our body and all of these little atoms that it's made of, you took a tweezers and you took out every little small particle of your body and laid it down, there'd be no life in any of it. Nothing would live. And they say, we don't know, where does life come from in the body? How do we get life? I mean, what's this about? You have rechargeable items. You have a phone. I got my phone here. I can never keep it charged. I mean, my goodness gracious, I gotta take this thing, I gotta plug it in at night. What do? I simply head up the stairs, lie down, and I go unconscious for 6 or 7 hours. Next thing I, battery's full charged again. What's that about? I'm telling you, I'm not plugged in. It's weird. Yeah, see, there's that part of us that is so important. We're not like anything else you see around. And when that leaves our body, we're dead. I sometimes illustrate this with a rechargeable tool. If I have a rechargeable tool, there's two parts to it. There's the tool itself, and then there's the battery that goes into it. And the other day, we were doing something out, and we had an impact wrench taking some bolts out. And I grabbed the impact wrench and pulled the trigger, and there was nothing. I'd forgotten to put the battery in. The minute I put the battery in, the thing began to hum and do its work, because that was the life of the machine. The most expensive part was that part that I could see. The impressive part was that. But the battery, without the battery, there was no life. So it is the same with us. When our spirit leaves our body, it's like taking the battery out of us. And the body is lifeless. And we can cremate it. We can bury it. It doesn't matter. Because the spirit is gone to be with the Lord. So one God, two parts to us, three. God's plan for our life includes three stages. The scripture teaches that the Bible promises Christians three stages of life. Stage one, we read it today, is when Paul says in verse 6 of the reading today, we are at home in the body and away from the Lord. So right now, my spirit is in my body, and I'm here before you, and I will tell you the scriptures say that this is a body being operated by a spirit. And you say, Lauren, with a body that big, you must have a V8 spirit. Well, probably I do. Running on diesel, too, I think. But I got to tell you that this is a body being operated by a spirit, and I am at home in the body, but I'm not in heaven. I'm away from the Lord. Now, the Lord is here with me. I'm not trying to say, Paul is not saying that. But this is scripture I'm reading to you. We're at home in the body and away from the Lord. Stage two. I can be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Get that now. At some point, I'm going to leave my body and go home to be with the Lord. That's what Fred did. Dirty stinker, he should have waited till he got back to Newfoundland. But, you know, he had to go. He's at home with the Lord. You say, well, Lauren, how does that work? Don't go asking me questions I can't answer. I mean, I've never seen a spirit. You can't see a spirit. A spirit is like, it's that life force within us. It's all of us. And the spirit leaves the body and the body goes flunk. Just like I take the battery out of the cordless drill and it goes bang. Nothing there. Okay? So away from the body, home with the Lord. First of all, I'm at home in my body and away from the Lord. Then I'm away from the body and at home with the Lord. That's verse 8. And stage 3 is from 1 Corinthians 15. And it says, listen, I tell you a mystery. I'm sorry. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. We're at home in the body and at home with the Lord. So stage one is that I'm at home in the body and away from the Lord. Stage two is I'm away from my body and at home with the Lord. Stage three, scripture says, is I'm at home in the body and at home with the Lord. There's going to come a time when my spirit is coming back into my body. 1 Corinthians 15, 51-52. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. At that resurrection moment, Fred's spirit will be put back in his body, and his body will come together, and he will go home to be with the Lord in that new body. That's the three stages of Christian life. Now, how do you get that to happen in your life? How do you get in on that plan? Well, we don't believe Fred is absent from the body and present with the Lord just because he was born. We don't believe that Fred is at home with the Lord right now just because he attended church. The Salvation Army can't get you to heaven. We can't do it. Then how? Well, it's all there in the most famous verse in the Bible. John 3:15-16 says this, "Even so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believeth in his name should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." John chapter 11, which has a marvelous, marvelous story about Lazarus, the most famous passage of scripture probably in the New Testament, Lazarus being resurrected from the dead. He'd been dead for 4 days, and the people were weeping, and Jesus makes this incredible statement to Mary, his sister. He says, "Mary, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die." And what did he do to prove it? What did he do? He raised Lazarus from the dead in front of critics and friends alike. Well, we mourn Fred's passing today. And though we will miss him like crazy, and though we certainly don't have all the answers as to why, our sorrow is not near as devastating as it could be, because we know that we can see Fred again one day and spend an unbroken eternity together in heaven if we want to. In fact, if I could have spoken to Fred, can you get your music? If I could have spoken to Fred, I might have said to him these words that Ella May has asked me to conclude with in my sermon. Can I hear a key? I would have said, "Hey, Fred, when you finally make your entrance into that city of jasper walls and bright golden avenues, as you behold all its beauty and its splendor, just one reason. She was 90 years of age, all the family was standing around. I know you've heard me tell the story. I like to tell the story. And we stood around, and as we looked at our saint of a mom, let me tell you what, she was something else. She had 11 children, 99 months pregnant. I got to tell you, that's a life sentence. 11 children. And they weren't all sweet like me, let me tell you. Right? So we stood around that bed and we watched her. We stood around. And I'm not like the car dealer who won't drive his own brand of car. I'm telling you. I believe this stuff. And we stood around and we said, Mom, look for me. For I'll be there too. And the funeral directors came in. You'll like the end of this story. The funeral directors came in and they brought the cart to the hallway. And they said, you know, we can't get the cart down to the room, so we'll just pick her up and bring her out. So I was in the room with them as they wrapped her in a sheet. And when they went to lift her, I said, stop. Stop. That's my job. And I reached down and scooped up my mom. First time I ever picked up my mom in my life. Held her in my arms. And when I picked her up, her head just flopped over on my chest. And I said, perfect. And I brought her out and I laid her down on the gurney. And do you know what I said to my family? See that? I did for her body what the Lord Jesus did for her spirit. He came and took the spirit of her body and took it home to be with Him. How comforting. I'm not saying this just to make you feel better. I'm saying it because it's true. So I say, you could decide right now to say, look for me. Hey, Fred, look for me. I'm going to cling to Jesus. I'm going to be there too. Would you like to stand and we'll sing it one more time? Make it your declaration of faith as we sing it. Look for me, for I will be
waiting.
Come on, sing.
Look for me.
Every family member would realize that reunion one day when you all meet around the throne in glory. Get ready to meet the Lord as your loved one did. Fred loved the Lord, is now in his presence. Thank you, Major Lauren, for that great word today. Spoke to all of us, I believe, and challenged our hearts, and I trust brought encouragement to each person here today and those who've been viewing us at home. Look for me, for I will be there too. Well, this final song that we're gonna sing was one of Fred's favorites as well, I understand. And we're gonna sing it, Onward Christian Soldiers, Marching as to War. Onward then, ye people. Join our happy throng, blend with ours your voices in the triumph song. Glory, laud, and honor unto Christ the King, this through countless ages, men and angels say. Well, we march on, don't we? Realizing the prize is before us, and oh, that we would be faithful to the Lord. What can Let's have a good sing.
Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as in war, with the cross of Jesus, glory gone before. Christ the royal master, the fold, more worthy
God bless you, each one, all family members today, friends that have gathered. May you go in God's peace today, and may you know of His presence guiding you through this journey. Be faithful one day. Oh, that we would all have a reunion and see Fred again and be in the presence of our Lord and Savior. Major Brother.
Shall we pray? Lord, we thank you for the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we would be hopeless if we came to a moment like this, in a service like this, to remember a person like this, without we knew that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. And all that he requires of us is that we would but believe. And we too would know his resurrection power. Thank you, Lord, for Fred, a life well lived, a man who never in any way intentionally would try to hurt anyone, a man of peace. And we thank you, Lord, for your spirit, which was evident throughout the living of his life. We thank you, Lord, as well for his family. And we pray your continued blessing upon them, because although we do not grieve as those without hope, we still grieve. And so I just pray in these days that you would be especially close to Ellie Mae, and that she would sense and know your presence. She knows Fred has gone to a better place. She has a deep-dyed faith of her own. And we thank you, Lord, that she is trusting in you. Lord, help us to trust you, Lord. What else have we got in this life that compared to the life-giving presence and power of God's Holy Spirit active in our lives when we commit ourselves to you? So, Lord, dismiss us now with your blessing, and may each of us be challenged to serve you better day by day, and to be your light in a world which continues to know so much darkness. In your lovely, matchless name I pray. Jesus, amen.
There is a reception at Paul and Michelle's following the service, like now. Even though Paul and Michelle aren't there, the reception is happening following the service, and my bold to say, all are welcome. Anyone who would like to come, come along. God bless you.